Our first luncheon presentation will be given by Joe Arnold with SwiftStack and Dirk Peterson with Fred Hutchinson Cancer Research Center. I'd like to welcome both to the stage. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Joe Arnold, and I'm from a company called SwiftStack, and we're based out of San Francisco. We're definitely a growing company in the storage space. Even opened up an office in San Jose and San Francisco. So if anyone is in systems engineering or file system development, we're absolutely hiring. So just need to say that to get that out of the way. This is the required slide that everyone at BioIT World is required to put in their slide deck, otherwise they're not allowed to present, which shows the cost of the genome sequencing ever decreasing. I'm joined by Dirk Peterson of Fred Hutch, who was really early involved with deploying our software, and they had a problem, right? The challenge was they needed something that was low cost because they were dealing with this influx of data. They had to get high throughput in and out of their HPC clusters, faster even than S3. And so those were some of the constraints that they had.
Let me say, so we are cancer and HIV research center in the West Coast. Many of you might have heard of us, a comprehensive cancer center. It's over 3,000 employees and very well connected across the planet. We had recently done an analysis of our Dropbox relationships, and we are a conservative IT shop, just to say that. We're not always on the cutting edge.
So what does SwiftStack do? What we provide is an object storage system. And the way we like to kind of frame it is it's like what you'd find in a public cloud, but we enable our customers to run it behind their own firewall, in their own data center. And the things that they've been looking for are freedom of choice. So that's the ability to select what kind of hardware platform that they want to run on. This runs on standard server infrastructure, stuff that people are already buying. They want the freedom of open source. So at the core of our technology is an open source storage runtime that actually does power the large public cloud. So namely, Rackspace, IBM's public clouds, even Oracle's public clouds are being powered by OpenStack Swift. And what we've done is, as a company, we've built a product which enables our customers to deploy that themselves without necessarily hiring a big group of DevOps engineers to get that running in their own data center. So, but still get that flexibility. One of the other interesting attributes of this model is the scalability model. And instead of deploying infrastructure all up front, making a big capital purchase, having the flexibility to add infrastructure node at a time, rack at a time. And even at the extreme, some people will buy out empty shelves and then fill disk drives as they need them. Applications, so for today and tomorrow. The reason why we're talking about this is we've noticed a trend in how people have been building applications. It started with people who were building web and SaaS applications. Those were really the early customers of people that were consuming public cloud, like out of Amazon. And S3 is a storage API, which is very predominant. And as this has become more mainstream, more and more applications are supporting object APIs. But that's not sufficient. While people want to get to object storage native applications, we've also supported file-based access into that same storage system. So those are the tenets that we're building upon. We're focused on a few use cases. Life sciences is a very strong one for us, and media and entertainment is another one. So what the architecture of what this looks like? There's two components now to storage systems. There's the actual storage rack, which is running the software, and our architecture has OpenStack Swift, which is the open source project at the core. It's the storage runtime, but then you need to stitch together and complete that whole runtime. So things like load balancing becomes super important, having things like that baked into the platform. The other thing from a management point of view is that's no longer done just on those nodes themselves. It needs to be decoupled. It needs to be decentral. It's not central to the actual storage environment. And the management plane is orchestrating a single namespaced cluster that can exist across multiple data centers. And so we have this controller, which is that management plane, and that really reduces the time that it takes, the operational time it takes to run and manage the environment. So that's what we have. It's based on open source. Now, we're the leaders of this open source project, but it's a growing open source community. The reason why that's important is because there's leverage. There's a broader ecosystem of people who are deploying this, who are working on this, who are collaborating this, and it's only snowballing, and it's been accelerating, as you can see in recent years, on even just the number of developers that are working on the core storage engine. So some use cases, in particular for life sciences. We'll dive into Dirk's here in a second, but this is it's a storage cloud. And it was an economy file project so that you could charge back to organizations to reduce the cost of storage. And we have capabilities like chargeback, so we can meter how much storage people are using, different projects are using, so you can do chargeback. The middle one is Hudson Alpha, and so specifically they are working on a sequencing workflow to take in samples and then distribute whole sequences back out to customers. And so working through and instrumenting that whole process, and now they provide that as a service. Third one is Council. Very similar, they do the sequencing, but then they produce a result, which is a report back out to a clinic. And so that's the Council use case. So this is direct integration with Illumina HiSeq X clusters and moving that data through HPC environments to doing the processing and delivering either the resultant data out to an HPC environment where it gets consumed, like what Dirk's going to talk about, or processing that down into something that a clinician can consume and deliver a report to a patient. So those are just some examples of customers that we have in this space. So tying it all together, we have modern applications that are consuming object APIs. We're working with partners like Vir to tie in with file-based workloads, and we have integrations to move data into public clouds. So this is the architecture that we have. Some more resources. We have a book here that goes into a bit more detail on object storage, particularly for genomics and in HPC workloads. If you want to check it out, there's a few copies up here that I encourage you to grab a copy of. And there's more resources. We have an O'Reilly book and more information to try the software out and just download it at our website. The other thing that we've done is it's not enough to just take open source, build a storage product around that. We also have to wrap that up in solutions. So we've worked with partners, with systems vendors that you're probably already buying from, like Seagate and Dell, HP, Supermicro, Quanta, and Cisco systems. A number of those we have very tight relationships with and resell relationships with, so that it's not a project to decide. Well, it removes the fear or the uncertainty out of deciding what hardware to get, because we've already been testing very specific stacks of equipment that can be purchased. And the other thing it allows you to do is it allows you to ride that cost to performance or innovation curve. So as every year new equipment comes out that is faster, cheaper, denser, that's always going to occur. And the advantage here is you can buy what you need to support how much storage you need today, and then add as you need it. And that can be every 6 months, it can be every year, and then the cluster rebalances itself across the available capacity. Instead of just migrating from one cluster to the new cluster and doing longer refreshes, you can add incremental capacity over a period of time, even mix vendors in the same cluster. All right, so back to the HPC's workload, generate data, it goes to an HPC cluster. Dirk.
Should I go?
Talk about the requirements that are required for the HPC workload.
Yeah, so for So first of all, I'll just do another quick status introduction. I'm here the third year now. I'm talking about Swift with Joe, SwiftStack. And it's been like this journey over 3 years. And there's some, as Chris Stack mentioned before in another talk, there's some repetition in there. But I always say, you know, if you repeat the same thing multiple years, then there's probably some element of truth to it. So there's also some new things in here. But in general, we wanted to not sacrifice the throughput to the HPC system. So basically, somebody wants to ingest a lot of BAM files. There's a concern when you put BAM files into an archive that that it's like psychological barrier to get it back, although you don't actually need that often, to be honest. But if you need it, you really want to stream it very fast. And so we wanted the high aggregate throughput, parallelized access, and we can get multiple gigabytes per second throughput in aggregate on our cluster today. It's from that perspective, it's really actually ideal for an HPC architecture. You need to do a little bit of twitching, but HPC people do that anyway, so there's a lot of twitching in HPC, so that's not a big problem. Talking about Swift Commander, so for us, you know, there's of course a little bit of management involved in enterprise IT to put boxes up and but most of the stuff management is actually done by SwiftStack, by the controller software. And what is up to us now is being like data engineers, data managers, and that's kind of where we focus on it at Fred Hutch. Swift Commander is a tool written mostly by my colleague Jeff Ketcher, and it makes Swift accessible to the average, I would say, moderately skilled scientist, Unix skilled, not skilled scientist, but moderately Unix skilled scientist who does a little bit of command line, and the Swift Commander does that very easily. It grabs another tool that is a standardized Swift access library written in Python, and so you always have the QA behind it that it actually works. There's a couple of new features I want to mention this year. We have parallel search going on, so you can basically do a full text search across 30 or 40 sessions. They run typically on multiple boxes, and it is extremely fast. I mean, there's not a lot of sense to do full text search on BAM files, but people have done it and they've actually found something. So that's a new feature. Then we included symbolic links. Of course, you don't have to wait long until somebody says, oh, my POSIX files are my symbolic links, and object storage does not support them. We can now do a symbolic link upload and restore them also. And with advanced permission management for Swift accounts, it's easier. So you use something like SWC chgroup, which is really familiar for Unix people, so you don't have to remember a lot of new things, and it makes it very easy. It's a training of about 5 to 10 minutes for somebody until they can use Swift Commander. It's used at Hudson Alpha, and actually a lot of people have downloaded and using it as well. A new thing. This is just starting. We haven't done anything with it. I'll probably report next year. Is cloud bursting with Avia. Chris Dagg mentioned there's a lot of Avia deployments now, and we have also the intent to use it mostly for cloud bursting. SwiftStack is the on-prem object store that you can see there, here, right? And you can then make that available on-prem and also cache it into the cloud, so you can have a single mount point everywhere where you go. That's really important. You don't have to stage your data anymore, and people don't ask, so why do I have to copy my data to the cloud? That's not great. Here it's all just there. It just takes sometimes a little longer to get there. So command line clients are great, but some people want GUIs. And so especially for our Mac and Windows population, we have tested several tools. I've presented some last year, and there's a bunch of them out there. Currently my favorite one is called Mountain Duck. It works on Windows and Mac. The benefit of it is it's based on CyberDuck, which you may know. And CyberDuck has a core engine that's 5 years old, so it's actually very, very mature software that you can also use to mount SFTP clients. So if you download something from a sequencing center, they often have SFTP, and you can use the same tool for that. It works pretty well. Some other use cases are Commvault. So it's mostly Swift is about this, like storing like large BAM files, storing archive data, but also doing desktop backup. And Commvault, we use it for, we replace these wonderful caching devices with SwiftStack that you often have in order to meet your backup window, your 24-hour window. And then people put dump these on like disk before they go to tape. And we just use SwiftStack for that. So what comes into play here is that you can actually use the same core infrastructure. I mean, you're all aware of it. You have a lot of different storage systems, and you have to hire more people to manage more storage systems. And we try to actually focus where it makes sense to have like one architecture, one deep disk, which is SwiftStack, and then reuse it for multiple purposes. That really reduces your effort. Synology is a consumer grade NAS device that is becoming more and more interesting, and people for like use bench instruments in the lab. They want to have sometimes an adjacent storage device, and Synology can be backed up through SwiftStack. So we if people want to really do that, we don't recommend it to buy your own. But if people really want to do that, we would suggest Synology because we can back it up. And then CloudBerry Lab is also a backup tool that we use to back up SQL Server in some labs. So there's a lot of talk about metadata. We have a fairly, I would say, simple approach to that. So researchers can actually, they can actually just add another command line argument to Swift Commander, key value pair separated by a colon. So it's your project, ran something, you have collaborators, blah, 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 and it's about breast cancer. And then SwiftStack is currently, I think, close to releasing something that does it better. We talk about it in a second.
Next slide.
We also have a GUI approach to that. It's basically a simple wrapper using Easy GUI and CX Freeze to deploy the Python Swift client to Windows workstation for data ingest. So somebody sends like a 10 terabyte hard drive, and then they can just right click on the folder and pump it into Swift at the highest speed.
Here you go. And last couple of slides here. So metadata indexing, as you saw, Dirk is adding metadata into the system. And what happens is the metadata can go in. We're adding capability to integrate that into an Elasticsearch environment. So metadata will go synchronize with that environment. And then the application can then query that Elasticsearch environment, get a list of URLs that then the application can go query that data from. And just a kind of a quick demo of what that looks like. In order to configure that into the product, there is middleware. And the middleware, you specify the Elasticsearch environments that you have or have set up. And this is very analogous of something I just ran on my laptop. I knew it would be short on time, so I didn't want to do it live here. But tagging an object with metadata. And then that metadata will be shipped out to an Elasticsearch environment. And Elasticsearch, of course, you can layer on a Kibana dashboard. And you'll see here we have that metadata that we just entered into the system, and that's fully queryable. And we can also use that to build dashboards. So here we're going to take some of that data, build a pie chart of different types of data so we can see the distribution of different of data that's been tagged in a certain way, and then you can accumulate all those together into a dashboard. And that is it. Thank you for the 5-minute warning. So I think, in conclusion, right? Technology is driving this discovery. We're thrilled to be a part of the missions of the companies that that are using our software. We really feel like we're enabling people to operate at a larger scale. To achieve a broader mission by allowing them to store more data, allowing them to get more of that data into those computational environments. It's been exciting to be a part of. And thanks for your attention today.
Thank you.
Any questions?
We have one or two questions.